It's the Opperman Report. Join digital forensic investigator and PI Ed Opperman for an in-depth discussion of conspiracy theories, strategy of New World Order resistance, high-profile court cases in the news, and interviews with expert guests and authors on these topics and more. It's the Opperman Report. And now, here is investigator Ed Opperman.
Okay, welcome to the Opperman Report. I'm your host, Private Investigator Ed Opperman. You can find me at Opperman Investigations and Digital Forensic Consulting, normally by going to my website, but for now, just email me at OppermanInvestigations@gmail.com. If you like our show, be sure and go to our Patreon, Opperman Report Patreon. We put up all the shows you hear Monday to Friday on AMFM Radio. You can hear at Patreon with the ads cut out, ad-free, commercial-free. Our archives are free at Spreaker.com. You can go there, sign up for free. There's a chat room, and you get an email notification when I put up new content. And also, too, I do a live show Friday night, a solo show every Friday night exclusive to Spreaker. If you notice, I'm rushing through the intro because our guest today, Billy Prophet, and you can find his website, is Friends of Brother Billy. Okay, and he's sitting right now in a prison at La Nueva Joya, a prison, Section C, over there in Panama. Okay, so we have a limited time with our guest today, Billy Prophet. Mr. Billy Prophet, are you there?
Hey, how you doing? Yeah, my name is William Dathan Holbert. Billy Prophet is a handle that I use, or a Facebook account that I use to kind of reach out to people, because sometimes for me, being in prison, it's a little dangerous to use my real name. And so my real name is William Dathan Holbert. Everybody calls me Wild Bill. I was a professional cartel hitman from 2006 to 2010 in all of Central America. I'm serving a 46-year sentence for quintuple homicide here in the worst prison in Central America. When I say the worst, it's the most dangerous. More people are killed on the inside, and there's more violence in this prison than any other prison in all of Central America. I was put in prison in 2010, as I said, and I've been in prison for 12 years. And so that's who I am, basically. And one of the things that's amazing that happened in my life as well is that in the last 6 or 7 years, I began to do missionary work inside the prison, evangelist work inside the prison. And I'm actually, in 2020, was appointed as chaplain of the prison in which I'm in. So I'm actually an inmate, but I'm also the chaplain of the prison here, so I'm the pastor of the church on the inside. And it's just really great to be here, and I'm really thankful, and God bless your listening audience, and thank you, Ed, for the opportunity to be on your show.
Well, I tell you, man, that's an incredible mouthful. Okay, that's a lot to lay out there in one sentence, man. I got to hand it to you. Okay, how does one wind up becoming an international hitman for cartels? How's an American wind up down there working for the cartels as a hitman? Did you have, like, military training? How does this work?
Well, I'll tell you, it's, you know, you don't wake up one day and say, you know, I'm going to be a hitman. I'm going to be a professional killer. That doesn't happen. It's not like it's one step after another step down into the hell that is the underworld. And, you know, a lot of people in your homes there, and me, when I was, you know, still a civilian in the States growing up. I grew up in Western North Carolina, a very southern, very country, very rural area. And I mean, it's just an incredible thing that a man from there would be here doing what I'm doing, or what I was doing, and then what I'm doing, even doing now. But how does one become a hitman? Well, it's a lot of small mistakes at first. And I think that that's one of the things I want to talk to your audience about today, is like, you really need to be very careful about your decisions, because it's not just one big decision. You make one big bad decision, now your life's wrecked. I mean, like, my life was wrecked. I mean, literally wrecked. And I wrecked it. How did I do it? One little bitty decision after another. What you focus on in your life is what will happen to you. That's 100%. And so I focused on negative things and making easy money. And then after, and then another thing about it is, you know, you get started in small things. Like, I got started in fraud, and I had businesses in the States. I grew up in a really, really, really good family. My family's an affluent family. My grandfather was the mayor of our town. It was a small town, very small town, like 800 people, Saluda, North Carolina, which is it's outside of Asheville, North Carolina. That's the big, you know, the big provincial capital. capital of Western North Carolina. Anyway, and so, I mean, as this, the firstborn son of a very affluent farmer, it's a strange thing for, you know, to be in Panamanian prison serving 46 years for quintuple homicide as a hitman. How did that happen? It happened after, you know, a lot of small mistakes. I began to make easy money and got addicted. It's so addicting. And another thing about it is when you do a criminal act and you make money and you get away with it, you're going to do it again. I mean, a lot of people, including myself, many times said, hey, after this one, I'm done. After this one, I'm done. And it doesn't work that way. It's like a heroin fix. You know, you say, well, after this one, I'm going to stop. And it's just, you're just lying to yourself. The only way to stop is to stop. And in my case, I was stopped and ended up, I was in Western North Carolina. I grew up there. I had three or four businesses. I actually led a right-wing militia. You'd ask if I had any military training. Not really, not military training that would be considered formal, but I led a right-wing militia. It was not a racist organization. People have said that's not true, actually. It was a racially mixed organization, actually, but it was a right-wing militia in the States. And, I mean, like, just one bad decision after another. I ended up having to leave the States as a fugitive for being a fool and breaking the law. And anyone listening to this program who is breaking the law or considering to do so, I'll tell you that the fruits of those actions are going to be very bitter, and they always come to pay, because there's only two places that we criminals end up. One is the cemetery, and the other is the prison house. And so I'm in the prison house. God loved me enough not to allow me to be killed, even though I killed many other people. But the fruits of my terrible deeds are very bitter. My life has been very difficult of my own making for the last 12 years. So that's one of the things we want to talk about today is what you know, where are you going with your life? If you're concentrating on negative things, you know, then your life is going to be very difficult in the end, even if it's easy now. If you want, I remember Les Brown, who was a motivational speaker, said that if you do today the things that are hard, tomorrow your life will be easy. But if you do today the things that are easy, tomorrow your life will be hard. And that's true in my case. So a kid growing up in Western North Carolina who pays a lot of attention to terribly negative things, and dabbles in crime, and maybe doesn't get the discipline, the punishment that he needed in order to straighten himself out or be straightened out one step after another, even though he comes from a good family, this could happen to your kids.
So Billy, we really have to be very careful. Let me ask you a couple of questions. Now, you were facing some charges here in the United States that caused you to become a fugitive. What were those charges?
That's true. It isn't true. The thing that happened to me, and there's like a turning point in everybody's life, right? And the thing that happened to me that made me go completely rogue, because I was like lukewarm criminal, meaning I had businesses and stuff and ran my businesses. And then, like, I sold the stolen heavy equipment and participated in frauds with other people and things like that to make money. But I had the face to the world. Was the face of an upstanding businessman, and I was a young man. I was, you know, 24 years old when I left the state. But I built a $300,000 house, it was paid for, and, you know, I mean, I had a really, and this we're talking in 2004, I was, you know, a really affluent young man, but all that money was illicit, all of it. And so I think that the thing to remember is to answer your question, what I did was I went through a divorce, and the judge in the divorce, I broke a judge's order. Now, I wasn't violent. My ex-wife withheld the children from me, and then I withheld the money after she withheld the children. The judge gave my wife a $20 fine, and he gave me 2 weeks in jail. I didn't think that was fair. At that time, it wasn't fair. I mean, but that's not a reason to throw your life away, you fool, but I did. And so after that, I went rogue. It's really the right thing that broke me. That didn't break me. Even if he made a bad decision, it doesn't justify anything that I did. And I don't want to make that. You know, I really repent of the things I did. I want to make sure that everybody understands that. But in my mindset at the time, I thought if they're gonna make me a criminal, then I'm gonna show them the best doggone criminal that there is. And I did. And so I I did a few things there, pulled some frauds and a few things, and I got about $300,000 or $400,000 put together, and I left the United States. And so I came to Panama. I came to Costa Rica. I didn't come directly to Panama. I had been to Costa Rica on vacation. And so I went back just because I knew there that place, just because I knew where it was, and I knew that it was kind of safe. So I skipped out on all those things and went to Costa Rica to start a new life. And as a fugitive from the United States, you can't just open a business and say hi, you know, because you don't have any papers or anything like that. And so you kind of fall in with the same crowd that has problems. And that's another point that needs to be talked about here in Central America. Very few Americans are living who don't have problems. You know, if you're an American who doesn't have problems, you don't leave the United States to live, or at least you don't come to the third world. And I did that. I did that, and a lot of other people did too. And so it was really easy to fall in with that crowd because most of the people here are just like me, people who had legal or some sort of a problem in the United States. And so that's what happened to me, and that's how I got from point A to point B. And I began, the first thing that I did was I began captaining a ship, because I'd worked a lot in the ocean in South Carolina, in Charleston, South Carolina, as a boat captain. I captained a ship that was a human trafficking ship, and it wasn't slaves. It was people who had paid money to be, it was like coyote, is a better word. Human trafficking is kind of not really what was happening, but it's like being a coyote and piloting a boat. And so that's how I got started in organized crime in Central America, and it grew from there.
Well, you absolutely wouldn't be the first man to be destroyed and broken by the family court system in the United States, that's for sure. I had an 18-year nightmare with the family court system in the United States of America. It's designed to destroy people and clean you out every dime you got. But let me ask you this. Now that you've had this, because you have had a rebirth experience, we're going to get into your whole life and stuff like that, but now that you're a changed man, you've had this rebirth experience, you've devoted your life to Jesus Christ, have you been able to make amends with your children and your ex-wife?
I have not, actually. I have not been able to do that. And actually, I think that in these times, it's a sad situation. Actually, I'd love to do that, but I haven't been able to. And God bless them. They're doing very well. My ex-wife's not doing well at all physically. Hmm. She's very ill, but my children are doing very well. And even though I'm not able, the family that I do speak with, my mother and others speak to them. And so they're doing very well, and I thank God for that. And I actually have adopted. I have a son. I have a one-year-old son who's adopted here in Panama, and a new fiance. And so...
Gotcha.
So those are positive things that happen in a month.
So from doing the math, it appears you're about 32 years old right now?
No, I'm 42 years old.
42, okay, well, I can't do the math. Okay. I tried to do the math, but I couldn't do the math. Okay. Which is probably why we missed our appointment yesterday, because I couldn't do the math. Okay, so you're 42. Let's not get into that. But now, how many years do you have left over there in Panama?
Well, I don't know is the answer, and I'll tell you why. They gave me, when I was arrested, the maximum sentence for anything judged in one sitting was 20 years, and that's one of the reasons I confessed to so many murders. I thought, well, let's get them all cleaned up, because the maximum sentence in the Republic of Panama in those years was 20 years. You could not, you kill 700 people, you can't get more than 20 years then. We're talking in the year 2010. So I confessed a whole bunch of stuff, and then they took me 7 years to get me to a trial. They waited 7 years to take me to trial. When they took me to the trial, the law had changed. And then they gave me 46 years. And I'm like, wait a minute, you can't give me 46 years, because when I was arrested, the maximum was 20 years. And on that agreement with the fiscal, which means district attorney, with that agreement that I made with the district attorney, I was supposed to get 20 years. I'm going to live with 20 years. 20 years is livable. You can still survive it. 46 years is not survivable. And so I'm fighting with them right now. I think that eventually I'll win. I'm in the Supreme Court with that right now. So I know that the American embassy, really pushed hard for them to destroy me completely. Because the people that I, the at least three of the people who I was convicted of murdering were American citizens. Three of the hit contracts were American citizens. And so the United States, instead of, you know, and I can't blame them. I don't blame them. You know, I can't justify anything that I did, you know, and don't try to. And I just repent and move forward. There's anything else I can do. And so
And of course, still, you want mercy. You want mercy. You know, you can't change what you did, but you want mercy. Now, if you did manage to get out of...
Go ahead.
Yeah, no, that's okay.
If you did manage to get out of prison there, could you return to the United States, or you're banished forever?
Well, this is what happened to me. I had a meeting with the FBI, and the FBI sat down with me in La Jolla in 2010 and asked me, hey, we know you're an embarrassment to us, and the reason you're an embarrassment to us is because I got away from them. I beat them. There was a helicopter chase and everything when I was leaving the United States, and I beat them. I got away from them. And they're very angry about that. And they told me flat out, you're an embarrassment to us, and when you get out of here, stay here in Panama. Don't come back. You come back, and they told me in words that were very vulgar that we'll make you pay if you come back. But I've spoken to lawyers since then, and it's been more than 14 years, and there's nothing. I don't have anything in the States that is, like, violent. I don't have any violent crime in the States. I didn't, you know, rob any banks or kill anybody or anything like that. So really, I think that I could go back, but I don't want to. I don't have any. My life is here. I'm getting ready to get married, and my life is here. You know, and I have a church here, and I'm an important person here in the fact that I'm as famous, and this is not bragging. Well, I'm a humble man, but my name is as infamous in Panama as, like, Charles Manson or, I don't know, Ted Bundy is in the United States. But for different reasons, I'm not a serial killer. I was an international hitman. So I don't compare myself with anybody. If I compare myself with Paul, because Paul converted over to Christianity and then began helping the same people he was killing. And so that's exactly what I'm doing. I was killing criminals, and so now I'm helping criminals find Jesus Christ.
Right, if people want to understand what he's talking about, check out Acts chapter 9. You can understand the conversion of Paul and the road to Damascus. Now, you said that you were involved in smuggling, human smuggling, bringing people on this ship you were captaining. How'd you get from there, though, to becoming a hitman? That's a pretty serious leap.
I ended up killing a man. The first person I ever killed was in self-defense, something I didn't want to happen. And I really don't want to go through the whole thing, but
sure.
But I killed. It wasn't murder at all. It was self-defense, but we were involved in a criminal enterprise. He was a fugitive from the United States, and I was a fugitive from the United States. And he attacked me, and I defended myself, and then that defense, he lost his life. So here I am in a boat with a dead body. You know, things just got a lot deeper. What was an 8-year prison sentence now is a 48-year prison, you know, or 98-year prison sentence. I got a real problem. And so when that happened, the people who ran the operation helped me get rid of the body and get rid of everything. And they owned me from that moment forward and farmed me. And to be perfectly honest with you, I was so drunk and on drugs and enjoying the money that I didn't care. I had drowned my conscience in alcohol and illicit sex and things like that. So I'll just be straight with you. I didn't even have a conscience back then. Nothing was personal to me. I certainly never enjoyed killing anyone. I'm not a psychological weirdo or something. I think that if you enjoy killing people, something's really wrong with you. It was always something that I didn't enjoy very much, but I did enjoy the money. It came with it, and like every time that I would accept a contract or be ordered to do anything, I would feel very anxious, and when it was over with, I would feel great relief that it was over with. I didn't have to do it anymore. Do it at least for a long time. For a while, I won't have to do that, you know. And again, there's no way I can defend myself in that time because it's indefensible. I made terrible decisions, but again, as you can see through the story, it's one step after another down into hell. I mean, that's just basically how my life was until at the end of it. I was really a high level operative, and I was making over $1 million a year. And when I was arrested, I had several $1 million in cash, a mansion on the water, and I was so miserable. I mean, like, literally, I remember being so miserable. It took me a liter of Grey Goose vodka to sleep every night. I had to drink, and I didn't start drinking until 5 o'clock. And I didn't wake up drinking. I wasn't like an alcoholic in that way. But in order to to put down the comments, to put down the voices, you know, screaming in the back of my mind. I had, and I don't mean voices like schizophrenia. I mean like the voices of the people I'd harmed. I had to drink a liter of vodka every day. I mean, I knew that when I went to the grocery store, if I'm buying food for 10 days, I need 10 liters of vodka to go with that food. And so in order to exist, I had to be drunk and just to sleep. And it was more of like I had to pass out. And that's the only time I could get away from my own conscience. In a way, it was a relief when I was arrested. Really unexpected. I never expected to be arrested. I expected to be murdered. I murdered my boss. And, I mean, and that's what happens. You know, hitman, there's no retirement for him. You know, that's another thing. You know, if you're listening to this, you're a kid, you're listening to this, and you're, like, watching Sylvester Stallone. I mean, I don't know. I'm way out of date. Don't get me wrong. I'm way out of date. I've been in prison for a long time. Yeah. So you have to forgive me. You have to forgive me. But if you're watching some super action hero who's a hitman, you think, wow, that's exciting. It wasn't anything like that at all. There's nothing exciting. Or, I mean, it's impossible for me to tell you if you're in a room with three prostitutes and you know, lots of cocaine, that you're not going to enjoy that. You're going to enjoy that experience. But then afterwards, there's an emptiness that comes over you. You just can't use enough drugs or have enough illicit sex in order to fill that hole that is supposed to be filled by Jesus Christ. I mean, you as a human being, or at least I, you, everybody else, we were all created to serve God. And when we're not doing that, there isn't anything that we can do enough to fill that hole in us. And I couldn't do it. I couldn't kill enough. I couldn't eat enough. I couldn't, you know, drink enough. I couldn't fornicate enough. I couldn't meet momentary moments of happiness with the satisfaction of going to bed at night, knowing that tomorrow's going to be a great day. But none of that. And, you know, and I'm in prison, man, and I'm in the worst prison, and people die here all the time. Uh-huh. And I mean, like, daily, there's a murder here every day, at least one every day in this complex. There's 12,000 men here, and at least somebody's knifed or shot every day. And you know something? I would go to bed with the most secure feeling. I'm the most secure man. I wake up in the morning with a grin on my face. You know, I go to work. I love my job. I love the people I'm with. And I mean, like, that's not possible without knowing Jesus Christ. Or at least it wasn't for me. I could never find any satisfaction. And I'm so happy now. And I was so miserable when I was wealthy and didn't know Jesus. I was a miserable man. But you know, now I'm really, really satisfied with my life, even though it's terrible. My life is horrible. I mean, it really is. But, I mean, my standards, you know, my standard of living is appalling. But you know, I'm happy.
Billy, a little background for you. First of all, the average age of my audience is about 50 years old, you know, 45, 50 years old. So they'll have heard of Sylvester Stallone, but trust me, a 20-year-old kid wouldn't. Okay. He's done. Yeah, he's gone. Yeah. And also, too, my audience is very understanding, too, about people whose lives have changed. You know, myself, I was a career criminal myself. I was a smuggler. The people understand this story. I'm a Christian now. They're very, very understanding about that as well. Now, a question I have for you is, during your time, though, in your life of crime, like you were saying, that emptiness, that misery, before you got saved, was there ever a calling in your life? Can you think back now and say, oh, my God, God was calling me at that point? I even watched TV and watched an evangelist on TV, and I prayed with him. Anything like that?
When I was a kid, I grew up in a Baptist church. And when I say I grew up, I mean, I was there every time the doors were open.
Right.
And I remember being 12 years old. Now, check this out. I was 12 years old. I'm saying that's how old I was. I don't know. Maybe I was 10 or maybe I was 14. But I remember sitting on the very back pew of the church listening to the preacher. And this is a tiny little Southern church, a Southern Baptist church, independent Baptist, but it was a Southern Baptist church. Not, you know, not a Southern Baptist, but anyway. In a little tiny, think of, you can like see, you know, a place that never has 100 people in it, never. You know, 50 is a lot. And so on Sunday morning, sitting on the back pew, and everybody, I'm related to everybody that's there, literally. I'm sitting on the back pew and literally listening to the preacher preach a sermon and writing a sermon, feeling like I was called to preach the Word of God. I remember feeling that way. And thinking about it and wrestling with it. And having a conscience about it. And then when I was 15, I discovered girls and beer. I mean, really, it's really what happened to me. And I discovered I was really good at American football. And I began to play it and got popular, and that became my god. The popularity and the feeling of going to the parties and being the big man on campus became my god. And then when that ended, and it did end, I was kind of left, now what do I do? And so I began making money, and that became my god. And so I stuffed God down, just, you know, kind of stuffing him down, be quiet, you know, for in that way, until 2011, when crying inside of a third world prison cell, I accepted Jesus Christ in my life, became good. Yeah. Had to go to prison in a third world country where there isn't running water. There is not running water here. And here I became happy. I hope one day that God allows me to live long enough to be free again, because I'll tell you something. Getting into a beat-up car, beat-up pickup truck, and going to the store and buying, I don't know what, two microwave hot dogs and a Coca-Cola and sitting on the beach and eating them would be incredible experience for me. For you, that's a terrible day. For me, that would be the best experience. Or being able to sit down and do math problems with my 10-year-old son will be an experience that, because of the things I've been through in prison here, that I will never take for granted. And I think about things like, I tell the guys here, check this out. I tell the guys here this a lot. You know, we complain a lot, and we got a lot to complain about. We're in a bad spot. But then I say, you know, there's guys who are paraplegic, guys in a wheelchair. They can't move their neck, bring anything from their neck down. That guy would trade places with me, even though he's free and maybe even wealthy. Like Christopher Reeves, if anybody knows who that is, because I know I'm out of, I know he's dead, and I know I'm out of, the man who played Superman, he was in a wheelchair from the neck down. That dude would trade places with me to come here and be in prison but be able to walk around. Well, I'm the same way. I would trade places with the lowest of you on the outside. The lowest, this is another thing, kid, that you might be listening. I know that there probably isn't any kids listening, but, you know, like you said, there are not very many. Your average listener's 40, 45, 50 years old. But I would say to the kid out there, the lowest of the low, for the guy that works at the gas station making minimum wage, is light years ahead of me as the boss in prison. Mm-hmm. And I am the boss. I'm the elected representative of the prisoners here. There's not a man in this prison has more power than I do. When I say goes. And there's not another person on the outside that's living free that isn't better than me. So don't make mistakes. I wouldn't tell you don't get caught. I tell you don't make the mistake in the first place. You know, don't think that there's no shortcut in this life. Young man, young woman, old man, old woman, there's no shortcuts in life. We continually get punished because we believe somehow that there's a shortcut. There's no shortcut in life. The only way to success, the only way to happiness is through hard work and honesty.
Billy, you were doing so well in crime. You were a hitman. You seemed so successful, million a year. How'd you get caught?
I made a mistake. I did a terrible thing. I did a terrible thing I didn't want to do. I was ordered to kill a woman, and I didn't have any problem with killing women, but I didn't kill people who weren't criminals. That was a rule of mine. There's two rules I had. I don't kill anybody who's a civilian. That's what we said. I don't kill civilians, anybody who, you know, is not involved in organized crime. I don't kill them, and I don't work with anybody else. I never work with anybody else. And there was a drug trafficker who had traded in his wife for one of these cute little Panamanian girls, and they are good looking. And they're a lot of fun, too, but there's not a whole lot of substance there. And I'm marrying a Panamanian woman. And I was married. I actually had been married another time before to a Panamanian woman as well. And so I know what I'm talking about when I talk about these things. And the man wanted, he had, when he was with his wife, he had put everything in her name. And now he's getting divorced, and basically his divorce would mean in Panama that he owns nothing. And he was a very wealthy man, and he wanted to kill her because if he killed her, then he didn't have to divorce her. And I said, I won't do that. He said, I won't do it. I won't do it. And he said, and he went to the, it was like a loose federation of criminals. It's not like something off like the Godfather or the Mafia. You know, it's not true. But the cartel, I speak, was a loose federation. I was the murderer. I was the hitman. There was a guy who, trafficked drugs, the guy I'm talking about in question. There's another guy who trafficked arms, another guy who trafficked. And they're all foreigners. All of them, most of them American or from England. And so he went and cried to them, and they came and called me and went and asked me, would I reconsider because we have to support each other and blah, blah, blah. And I said, no, I'm not going to do that. And they put more pressure on me until I caved and I did the job. And I broke both of my rules. I killed a person who was a civilian. Even though she was married to a drug trafficker, she wasn't a bad person. I even know her very well. I knew her very well. It's another reason I didn't want to do the job. And then he was insistent upon being involved. And when the family members of the woman came trying to find him, he did. I won't say he framed me because I did do the job, but he moved in a way which liberated him from guilt, but yet put me in prison. And when they began investigating on me, my house of cards, my life fell apart. Because I can't fight this in court because I'm not even. I was living under an assumed name. I wasn't even myself, and so I ran. And when I ran, it got bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, and a lot of people got, a lot of people fell at the same time as well, and they began looking for me, and they thought that they had found somebody a lot bigger fish than they'd actually found. They accused me of a lot of things, and then found out later that it wasn't that way. It wasn't what they'd thought originally. So I broke two rules that I had set for myself, that I'd never work with anybody else and that I wouldn't kill a civilian. I really, today and in life, believe that it was the hand of God that got me, that put me in prison, because I think that it was a much greater sin killing. I mean, all sin is sin. All sin is equal. God hates all sins. But some sins carry bigger consequences than others. If you lie to your kids about Santa Claus, that's a sin. But if you're killing people, that's the consequences of those two sins were different. And the consequences of killing a criminal and the consequences of killing a poor innocent woman are very different as well. And I thank God that they put me in prison. If they didn't put me in prison, I'd be dead. I wouldn't be alive. There's no way. No way I would have lasted two or three more years in that line of work. I was getting too big. Somebody would have clipped me just for what I had. I clipped others for what they had. Somebody would have done that to me, justly so. And so I think that one of the best things, the best thing that ever happened to me in my life was that I got saved, but I would have never been saved if I hadn't gotten put in prison. So I repeat that and say the best thing that happened to me in my life is I got caught, because God stopped me and began to use me as his instrument instead of the devil's instrument, the adversary's instrument.
So Billy, though, when you first went to prison, though, you weren't saved at that time. You weren't saved yet. And your whole life experience was using force and crime to get your way, to live your life. Is that what you did when you went into prison?
I'll tell you the story about the first day, my first day in prison. I had been in the Ancon Judicial Center for 3 weeks as they investigated me. And when I got I've seen all the prison movies, I've seen all the prison movies. We all know that on your first day you have to hit the biggest guy so everybody thinks you're tough, and that, you got to be careful not to get raped and all these things. These things are in my head. I'm a great big guy, especially even bigger in Panama. I mean, the average Panamanian's about 5'8" and weighs 140 pounds soaking wet. So I'm the Jolly Green Giant. I'm 6'1", about 250 pounds. At the time, I was 6'1" and about 300 pounds. I was really fat. And so I'm in really very, very good physical shape now. I box with these kids all in here all the time. Anyway, I went to prison, so I'm like, they're taking me. The investigators are pretty nice to me, actually, because I'm a celebrity. They made me a celebrity. And so they're taking me to prison, and they guys like, just relax. We're taking you to La Joyita. It's not that bad. We're going to take you to a place where there are other people like you, high profile guys. It won't be that bad. So I was like, not believing them at all. And so we go walking down. I'm all chained, hand to head, foot chained. There's a cop carrying my meager belongings that I've been able to bring in, and some changes of clothes and some toothpaste stuff. So I get down into the pavilion, which is cell block. I get to the cell block, and it's like the high profile cell block. There's only 12 people there, 11, and I'm the 12th. And I go inside, and the cops take all his handcuffs and chains off, and they search me, and they bring me in. And then my friend, Leo Morgan, who's a British gangster, comes walking. I mean, I didn't know him before. He became my friend. I didn't know him. I never met him, never even heard of him before. but he's a high-level British gangster, comes walking out, and he throws me something, and I caught it, and it was an ice-cold Heineken beer. Wow. And he says, welcome to paradise. So I drank the beer, and I was like, and like, the cops are calling me sir, and, you know, and the only thing that they wanted was money. And so we lived like kings. There were, I mean, I'm not joking, we lived like kings. There were actually female police officers that came and worked as prostitutes, basically, there. It was just an incredible, I can't even begin to tell you. I mean, every cell had a firearm. I mean, like, I just can't begin to tell you how we lived there. It was, like, really easy. And I there was really no motivation at all to change. And I'm like, okay, my thoughts at that time were, I'll figure this out, and I'll figure this out, and I'll get out of this problem, because I know how Panama is, and everything is chorizo here, which means, like, sausage. Everything's sausage. Everything's corrupt. And so, you know, sooner or later, I'll be able to buy my way out of prison. But my case was the Americans got involved, and they put so much pressure on the Panamanian government, I couldn't buy my way out. And the Americans, again, and all I had, even to this day, are still my adversaries. The U.S. Embassy is an adversary. They're not a friend. And they put so much pressure on Panama to isolate me, and ended up being isolated for a while, and things got really rough. And on the, I said 2011, it was 2010, on November 24th, I was arrested in July 27th. On November 11th, I was a broken man, even though things were easy. They still weren't easy. I mean, you're in prison. It's not easy. And I was a broken man. My life was broken. My mother came to visit me, and she brought me a Bible. I hadn't spoken to my mother in 6 years. And this happened, and my wonderful saint of a mother came and brought me a Bible and told me to use it. And I threw it in the corner. I had no intention of reading that thing. And a guy named Bob, his name was Roberto Boucher, who was a Haitian Anglican priest. Imagine that. A Haitian Anglican priest began to visit me, and I tolerated him. He was such a nice man. Very sickly, great big bellies, little bitty skinny arms, black as Yates' face with a shiny bald head. And he would come to visit me, and I would tolerate him. And kind of, I felt like I was humoring him. I had no idea what a powerful man of God he was. And he began to sing to me songs that I listened to in the Baptist church when I was growing up. And I had an experience. I mean, like a real Holy Spirit touched me. I mean, just like broke me is the right word. I mean, like literally just took a sledgehammer to my fragile ego, broke me into little bitty pieces, and I became a wreck for weeks. Like a complete and total nightmare wreck. And one night I just broke down and said, you know, I love you, I'm going to serve you. And that wasn't entirely true, that I'll serve you. So I accepted Jesus Christ, but I still had one foot on one side of the fence and one foot on the other. So they took me to another prison. And when they took me to another prison, it was a country prison in a place called Chiriqui, where I would serve 9 years of prison time. And there, it wasn't 6 months before I was in control of the prison. And when I mean in control, I mean in control. Whatever happened, the warden had to ask me permission to do whatever he wanted. And so I was attending church. I was going to church. I was praying every day. But I also was making money off illicit things. I was, you know, working as a mobster, basically. And then that prison closed, and they built a new one. They built a new prison, because that prison was very dilapidated, and they moved us to the new prison. When they moved us to the new prison, I lost a lot of the privileges that I had in the old one. It was a lot stricter. In the old prison in Davida, I ate fast food every day. Girls that worked there were, like, all in love with me, and they would bring me food and stuff every day. I mean, like, that's how it was. If I wanted a phone, if I wanted a firearm, whatever, they'd bring that in right in. And so, like, here's this gangster who's mixing oil and water through mixing the church with like that mafia lifestyle. And I lived that way for a long time. I think I got annoyed. I think I annoyed the Holy Spirit constantly. But by you know, you can't. You got to choose one or the other. You can't. You know, a man who James talks about in the Bible, that a person of doble animo, a person who is doubts, a person who is on one side of the fence for a little while and on another side of the fence for a little while.
Are you there? Okay, we got him back. Now we have Billy the Prophet, William Holbert, who's sitting there in prison. Billy, we lost you for a couple of seconds there. Can you pick up where you left off, Billy?
I'm breaking up, brother. I don't know. I don't think it's me. Are you there?
Yeah. Okay, let's try this. Okay, we lost you there for a couple of seconds, but I got you back now. Can I hear you?
Sure, I can hear you fine.
Okay, great. So you were talking about how you were at the old prison and they were about to move you.
Yeah, sorry about that. We have a difficult connection here sometimes. Yeah, so what in that time period of my life, I was kind of a man living in two different pastures, you know. I had one foot on one side of the fence and one foot on the other side of the fence. I went through a long period of time that way, and the pendulum would swing one way and then back the other way. I would, you know, really get connected with the church, really get connected with Jesus Christ, and then go through a period of time in which I wasn't so connected. And many good things, I actually got to participate in many good things. We had, in the old prison there, it was full of tuberculosis patients, prisoners who had the disease, tuberculosis. And with the help of a couple of Baptist churches in the South, in North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia, we organized a kind of a drive, and we cured 27 inmates who had tuberculosis with injections. And there was no doctor. And actually, it was me that was giving the injections. And the medicine the medicine that we ended up buying actually was veterinary-grade medicine. But I couldn't afford, with the money that was donated, I couldn't afford to buy the actual antibiotics. And so I had to buy antibiotics that were set up for veterinary that were a lot cheaper. It was the same antibiotic.
Billy, trust me, Billy, my audience knows about that. We actually use some veterinary products here ourselves. People who don't have...
well, there you go.
Yeah, healthcare's gotten
really
so expensive here.
It was crazy. It's the same drug.
Yeah.
But like to buy them for, you know, and to buy them for humans was like 16 times the price. And so I bought a huge, you know, like 1,000-milliliter bottle of the drug for horses and was just applying it to the prisoners there, and it worked perfectly. And all 27, nobody died, and they were so sick. And I'm sure there's a lot of pictures actually of that time period. I think there's even some stuff on an old YouTube channel somewhere about that. But it was really cool. I mean, things like that were so wonderful. I mean, it feels so good. And then at the same time, what actually happened was I got elected as inmate representative, meaning the voice of the inmate, the body of the inmates, of the union of the inmates to the government, meaning I was their mediator. I still am, and I am the new person here where I am as well. And that put me in a position to try to maintain the peace, and to be honest with you, I did it in a terrible way, but the easiest way to maintain the peace was to explain to the inmates that if the gangs fight on the inside, you can't sell drugs. You can only sell drugs if you're not fighting with one another. So behave yourselves and you can make money. And if you don't behave yourselves, there's just going to be searches and the cops will be down on us all the time. And so that put me in a kind of a compromised position, actually, being that politician in the inside of the prison. I think that probably something that happens to a lot of politicians that begin honestly and turn out. I mean, it was kind of, it was micro, you know, the world's micro. But inside prison is like a pressure cooker, because whatever would be easy on the outside is really difficult on the inside. So what ends up happening is, like, things happen in a hurry, and I was put in charge of the prison in a hurry. Well, they constructed a new prison, and we moved to the new prison. And the new prison was supposed to be better. They had promised us a new prison for like a decade, and this was in 2016, the end of 2016, like October. And they constructed a new prison, and they moved us to the new prison, and 3 days in the new prison, and the water system collapsed. So there we are, stuck in the middle of a lot of places, right in the middle of nowhere, 25 kilometers from anywhere. They brought us, we were in the city, of David. They took us out of the city of David, and they brought us, you know, 25 kilometers out to suffer. And I mean, like, there was like, they would give us running water for 30 minutes in the morning and running water for 15 minutes in the afternoon. And another thing that made it horrible is that we were a group of 1,600 men in the old prison. They built the new prison for 950 men. I don't understand this. They should have built it for 2,000, but they built it for even less than we already were, and they brought us up and shoehorned us into this place. So we had cells that had 5 bunks with 11 people in them. My cell had 11 men in them. And so they give you a half an hour of water in the morning and a half an hour of water in the evening. Now, if you know anything about human beings have to defecate and urinate, and at odd times, not odd, at that time. So what ended up happening is all that excrement got rolled up into plastic bags and thrown out the windows, literally. I mean, think about this. Hell, 11 men locked into a room, and it's 900 degrees outside. I mean, in the middle of, they built the prison in the middle of a salt marsh right next to swampy creeks and something. It's just some mosquitoes. It was a terrible situation. We were actually very comfortable in the old jail, even though it was kind of dilapidated. We had running water and electricity. And so now we go to a place where there's absolutely no electricity inside the cell, not even a light at night to read by, and no water. So I had a job. My job there, they gave me a job at the new supervisor of maintenance. And so that let me go to any part of the prison. Like, I was the only inmate that could actually go to any part of the prison. And I organized a hunger strike there that we wanted detention from the authorities. We're dying out here. There wasn't any doctor either. We had no doctor. 1,600 men in a prison with no water and no doctor. I mean, there's like guys that have diabetes, so they're dying. So that went well, and they upped the water to 4 hours in the morning, 1 hour in the evening. That was actually livable. And then they brought a doctor who was a good friend of mine, actually, and I began to work in the clinic. Actually, I changed jobs and began to work in the clinic. The problem with the excrement being thrown out the windows didn't change because, again, more than 5 hours a day, there's running water 5 hours a day, but if you have to use the facilities at any other time, what are you supposed to do with it? You can't just leave it in a room with, you know, the overcrowding didn't change. You're still 11 men in a room for five, in a cell for five, and so you can't put it in the toilet because you can't. I mean, it won't fit. And then the next day, you wouldn't be able to flush it. So the men first, and so the government told the maintenance supervisor that the prisoners had to clean it up themselves, but they couldn't send us any like hazmat equipment. We had prisoners outside cleaning up human excrement in flip flops and with their bare hands, literally. And the prisoners were outraged by it. And again, I spoke to a British tabloid newspaper about the situation. I was contacted by them. I didn't actually look for them. They looked for me and had heard about what was going on there and they spoke to me about it. And I spoke to them. Well, when that happened, they were syndicated worldwide, I guess, or something. And the Panamanians picked it up as well. And when the Panamanians picked it up, it was me talking about, you know, these sort of things. And the government came down on me like a ton of bricks. And this was in 2019, in the very first part of 2019, January of 2019. And the government tried to transfer me to a punishment sector of another prison that was 500 kilometers away. Now, I've spent, at this moment, I had spent 9 years in the prison where I was. I mean, I knew everybody in the town. I was in a leadership position in the prison, and I didn't want to move because, I mean, I had my life, even though I was in prison, my life was really good. I mean, it really was good. I ate well. I lived well. I mean, nobody wants to be in prison, right? But hey, I had keys to the gate. I mean, I had the key to my own cell. They would literally, I would close myself in it. I would open myself at 5 o'clock in the morning and close myself back in at maybe 10 o'clock at night myself. And so, I mean, I was really in a position of trust with the authorities there, and the authorities did not want me to go either.
Well,
I fought with a lawyer, and a judge gave an order, said he don't move. He stays where he is. Then everybody was comfortable with that. One day in October at 4 o'clock in the morning.
Let me interrupt you, Billy. Because we're going to be out of time. We're going to be out of time in about a minute. But what I'd like to do is have you come back for another hour, okay? Now, right now, okay? Right. People listening right now, how could they help you right now if you need help right now? What could people do? Call the prison?
No. Go to Friends of Brother Bill on Facebook, or you can send me an email at PanamaPrisonMinistries@gmail.com. That's PanamaPrisonMinistries@gmail.com. Or the easiest thing is to go to Facebook and go to Friends of Brother Bill. It's a Facebook group there, and there's instruction. There's quite a few people already helping. We've got a... Like some volunteers that are making some phone calls and sending emails and stuff. So it'd be really great if you guys wanted to. We're not really asking for money, but we're asking for help. We're asking for anybody that would want to help us. Come and check us out and work out.
Is that Panama Prison Ministry or Ministries?
Ministries with an S. Panama Prison Ministries at gmail.com or Friends of Brother Bill on Facebook.
Friends of Brother Bill on Facebook and Panama Prison Ministries at gmail.com. Now, Bill. Halbert, thank you so much. Okay, and I know it's been difficult. You're calling us from a prison there, so the connection's rough. Okay, conditions are rough. But we want to finish up this story. So what we're going to do is we're going to have you right back. I'm going to call you right back, and we're going to do another hour with Billy Prophet, William Halbert, Friends of Brother Bill on Facebook, Panama Prison Ministries at gmail.com. Thank you so much.
Thanks, man.